us leave. Reflection will show this connection we can lean on each other. This is all we need to know.
I remember vividly about Manchester is how cold the winters used to be, and how the water was always freezing in the taps when you got up in the morning to go to school, and wearing shorts and not really wanting to because it was always freezing.
We didn't come from a very well-to-do background. You know, we come from the back streets of Manchester. We didn't have any training. We weren't born with silver spoons in our mouths, and we didn't go to universities of music and stuff. And so it was kind of a sort of street education. We sort of got our music from, you know, just listening to the radio and testing it out on street corners.
Come a baby lollipop, tell you why. Kiss is sweeter than an apple pie. And when she does the crazy rocking dance, man, I haven't got a chance. I call her lollipop, 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 lollipop.
We looked up to Big Brother Barry, yeah. But you see, we started so young. We were sort of never, ever apart. We were like all are more or less the same age. We always called ourselves triplets, just something went wrong with Barry, you know. But we just, you know, jokingly say that. But it's something that the three of us have had the same way of thinking, the same mentality, the same sense of humour, the same love of music that we've always loved since we was five or six, Robin and I, and Barry nine.
Here it is.
Robin, quite eccentric. Morris, always the man in the middle. Like the three Scouse brothers in Harry Enfield, you know, there's always one of us going, you know, stop arguing, you know.
Ah, the front room. This was doubled up at first. This was my mum and dad's bedroom, chiefly, but it was also a room where we actually started doing harmony, three-part harmony. When we first moved in, there was hardly any furniture in here, and it was a nice echo.
Dad used to have his drums set up in here, and he always used to have his back to the thing, and he'd be banging away on here, and his whole drum kit would be set up here, you see.
And Barry had his guitar for his birthday, and we actually all started breaking out in three-part harmony in this room, which is for the first time for us. And that's my earliest memory of this room. So it's probably where we actually first started singing.
My father, yeah. Always bringing great records home. He actually was an opera fan as well as a big band fan. And it would either be Glenn Miller, or it would be La Traviata, or it would be Bing Crosby, who was his idol. And then the Mills Brothers. It was from the Mills Brothers that we heard all about harmonies, and he would play these records non-stop.
The music and moonlight, the thrill of the June night, the charm of an old Spanish setting, the romance and all its glory, the start of the sweet love story. Ay, 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 ay. He won my heart, amigo. He said that he loved no one but me. So walk to the shop we go. Ay, 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 ay. There is the part to be the door. He'll bring the flowers, sing the bells will ring and ting-a-ling. So wish me luck, amigo.
I would say the Mills Brothers, regarding my dad's input from them to us, was professionalism. When you're on stage, you know, you, smile, because if you feel like crap and you look like crap, people will feel like crap too. But Dad would always be down the back going, you know, because that's what the Mills Brothers did, you know, and that's, I think Dad really wanted us to be a little white Mills Brothers, I think.
The three harmonies as such was a beautiful sound. We wanted to do that. We wanted to do that. And we started doing it. We started finding out what harmonies were, and it was all instinctive. It wasn't a matter of looking at music or learning about it at school, although you did sing at assembly, you know.
Excitement, actually, going up there, because it's been a long time since we were up there. So when I walked round the side and I saw the player, it all came back to me. I mean, it was like, I remember the entrance where we first stood by the wall and sang to the other kids. They didn't like us much, but we used to stand against that wall, tell jokes and sing.
Used to be clubroom in here.
Hang on.
That's the hall, of course.
My heart is beating like a drum. This is, we go along here.
Right.
Into this room. It's very intense for me. Because it's, well, it's 42.
Yeah.
This was assembly.
Yeah.
And we'd all stand over here. And there was a place where you had to put your pumps. Do you remember the pumps, school pumps?
Yes.
Yeah, I need to tell you that.
Jobs.
And they'd stand, the teachers would all stand, and we'd sing, all things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small. All things bright, wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all.
We still sing it today, sometimes. But not quite as well as that.
Oh, I don't know about that. But, wow.
In fact, in most choirs we were in schools, we were thrown out of. So it was interesting that we've ended up doing what we did. But it's most of the schools, because they didn't like us harmonising to God Save the Queen.
Well, we were sort of delinquents. I mean, we were always on the streets.
Yeah, it's a spot of bother. It was kind of light-hearted stuff. Well, it wasn't really light-hearted stuff. It's this sort of a bit of firebugs, actually, you know, is to go around and set fire to allotments and burn billboards down and things like that. And
No, I was a goody two-shoes. I was Mr. Perfect at school, you know. And Robin and Barry always burnt down shops and billboards and things. I wouldn't. Oh, no, I couldn't do that.
We built a fire behind a set of billboards, and it took the whole lot down to the main road. And I remember us going to the baths to go swimming after we'd started the fire, and watching the police and the fire brigade and the crowds all filling out on the road and watching. And we just stood in the crowd and watched as well. And we were standing next to the policeman, and we said, "What's happened?" You know, and the policeman said, "Don't worry, we'll get him." You know, and we're standing next to him. So we were very defiant. Not good kids, and I ended up in court, and I got 2 years probation, and it was not good.
The Bee Gees' first formal public performance occurred as a result of an accident with a record.
You remember the Saturday afternoon matinee?
Sure.
As well? In between the small films and the feature, the cinema owner would let you get up on stage and mime to a record. This is the way we went through these alleyways when we first had a record we were going to lip sync. I think it was a Paul Anka record, although I'm not sure.
I think it was Tommy Stewart, right?
At the Gaumont Cinema, the first time we ever got on stage. It's just down here.
It's interesting, this, because this is the first time I actually started to sing live.
Yep.
We never sang live before. Remember, we were little kids at the time, so...
Well, Morris and Robin were six, and I was about nine.
Yeah. This is where the singing career began. If it hadn't been for that broken record, we probably would have started singing, because we needed it. We had to be in a desperate situation for this to happen. This is where we broke the record. It's historical for us. That's it. There's the Gaumont Theatre where we performed, which is now a funeral salon. But that was the theatre where we first sang as the Bee Gees, but not as the name the Bee Gees. We, Johnny Hayes and the Blue Cats.
No, we were the Rattlesnakes.
The Rattlesnakes.
You're right.
And that's it now, and that's where we broke the record, over there on this curb here.
I think it might have been my grandfather who heard us singing in the lounge and thought it was a record. And they came in, and there's the three of us sitting on the bed singing in three-part harmony. And my father went, you know, bong, you know, what is this, you know? And so from then on, he became devoutly sort of supportive of what we were doing, you know? So he took us to the Russell Street Club, and we did our first so-called evening live thing for the audience, which we got half a crown for. And my goodness, they liked us, you know. But You know, if you look back, you realize they liked us because we were kids, you know, not necessarily because we were any good, but we were doing something. We were doing something that no one had seen before, and that's three kids singing a three-part harmony.
Must have been pretty good, too, to have your father, I mean, father, after all, a musician, a man who knew what he was talking about, backing you.
Well, he played on the drums, yeah, that night for us, and had done after that, even when we went to Australia. So it sort of brings me up to the point where we emigrated.
Why did they go? Your father wasn't getting anywhere.
Just wasn't getting any work. Yeah. And I think the police actually said, you know, it'd be a really good idea if you could take these kids to another country.
Were you as bad as that, seriously?
Well, I don't think we... Well, I think it probably saved us from going to reform school.
The Gibb family quit Britain in 1958.
My father worked the roads when we got to Australia. We were like 8, 9. And we started singing in a local pub up the road from our house the first time, and our father had to drive us. Well, we got more work. He got an agent who started booking us around hotels around Brisbane. My father just had to drive us everywhere, and we had to have an adult with us everywhere we went. So he had to give up his job to do that. We had a great childhood, all of us. I always refer to the time when I was 11 in the changing room of a stripper, you know, and I think to myself, would I be a normal child? No. But I mean, we never even had friends our own age. They're always like 10 years our senior and things like that. And most of the kids I went to school with, I couldn't relate with at all.
Robin?
Morris.
And Morris. Now you all sing together, eh?
We met a disc jockey called Bill Gates in Brisbane when we first arrived there, when I was about 9 or 10. He was very instrumental in guiding us in the right direction. He would invite us back to the 4BH recording studios in Brisbane and cut acetates in the auditorium. Obviously, the songs that we'd written, songs like The Echo of Your Love and Let Me Love You and Time's Passing By, songs that we'd composed at the time. And he'd record them and put them out on his show, Platter Chatter, in the afternoons, you know. And that was the kind of, really the first minor record experience we'd ever had. You had to really leave Australia to either go to the UK or America to go any further. And we knew by the time we left that whatever we were doing, we could only go so far, and then we had to get out.
The Beatles came to Australia, and that was a very inspiring moment for us, being a group. When they arrived in Melbourne, there was a million people in the city centre, you know, and it was like, we've got to do this. If we got to England, we could become like the Beatles, you know. And I think that to this day, people not of our generation do not realise how huge the Beatles really were. Even people like Michael Jackson, I don't think has the same aura, has the same... Whatever they did to the world, they did it to all ages. They didn't do it to one age, you know?
When the Beatles came on the scene, it was like, that's us. That's what we've been trying to do, you know? But in those days, I mean, our first record, the flip side of it was called Three Kisses of Love, and we were going, kiss me once, oh yeah, baby. And this is all pre-Beatles stuff. And we're going, wow, it's them. She loves you, yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, they're doing what we do, you know? And they were English, to boot. And also, there's a mystery about them. I mean, that with the Beatles cover blew me away totally. I just said, this is what I would like to be like, you know? The black polar necks, the half-shadowed faces, the moodiness, the mysteriousness, touchable but untouchable.
And Paul was my mentor. I mean, his bass playing was amazing. And every single Beatle record, and even now, I can play every bass line that Paul played. And that's how I learned bass, from the Beatle records.
We modelled ourselves on them. A lot of kids did, you know, a lot of groups did in those days. So the New York Manning Disaster record is a direct influence of that.
In the event of something happening to me, there is something I would like you all to see. It's just a photograph of someone that I knew. Have you seen? Mr. Jones.
So the first line, the first thought was in the event of something happening to me, which led us down this road to a mine. And I don't know how we got there, but it started off with
that. Can any of you remember who chipped in what, or is it too long ago?
Because it was going to be our first single, we wanted something that a title that captured the imagination of people, that got people's attention. The original title was going to be called Have You Seen My Wife, Mr. Jones? And it was a little bit sort of...
Yeah, bland.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it just told the wrong, sent the wrong message. But the New York Magnets, it was kind of, you'd see it on a label, you see when the record came in, it actually attracted people's attention.
You see, the week that we arrived in England from Australia was the week of release of Strawberry Fields. And it was probably the first song we heard on the radio when we arrived in England, and we all took two steps back.
I mean, that song in itself wasn't as complicated as Strawberry Fields was, because it was a very simple song, you know, when it's,
right.
It had that Beatles flavour in it.
Maybe someone is digging underground, or have they given up and all gone home to bed, thinking those who once existed must be dead.
There was a power failure of some kind, I think, and there was no light. The three of us sitting in the darkness on the steps of the elevator stairwell, we made believe we were in a mine, and we just took ourselves into that world. So there we were in the dark with no light, and we thought, well, what could come from that? And in the event of something happening to me is where it started.
In the event of something happening to me, there is something I would like you all to see. It's just a photograph of someone that I knew. Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide, Mr. Jones.
We sent all our records we made in Australia, all the LPs, acetates of new songs, tapes of new songs, all to the Epstein agency. We sent them to Brian Epstein. You know, about a week after that, we got a phone call from a Mr. Stigweed. My mother said, interesting. Robert was the managing director of NEMS, Brian Epstein's company, and Brian had and he had had a few drinks one night and decided to play all the tapes and things that they'd received from all over the place. And ours came up, and Robert saw something in the songs. He thought, these guys are good.
This whole industry is about flag flyers, champions, who champion your cause. And one voice that can actually move mountains for people. And Robert Stigweed to us was a blessing. He was the man.
What glowed was the belief. Whoever this man was, he really believed in us. And that elevated us. It made us do... It made us go to work. It made us think on a much higher level than we had before. He gave us £300 and said, go and find some clothes, because the clothes you're wearing are completely unacceptable. So he sent us to Carnaby Street, and we came back with clothes that were completely unacceptable. So because we didn't know. I mean, we couldn't have been greener, you know. But Robert was very good with us. He was almost like a parent. He wouldn't let us get big-headed about it. And he would always bring us down to earth and say, one hit does not a career make, you know. And he was always there to tell us that. Two hits does not a career make. And even on our third hit, he would say, you know, stay calm.
Feel I'm going back to Massachusetts. Some
because we were American inspired, we wanted to write something about America, so it became our song about flower power. The record of San Francisco, everybody was going to San Francisco. We thought, well, why not a song about everyone going home? The lights all went out in Massachusetts because you went to San Francisco, because you left. There was something special about that thought.
And the lights all went out.
They brought me back to see my way with you.
We say, let's write Elvis Presley's new record. Let's write the Beatles' new record. What would they write? And then we'd sing it and it'd be us. You know? So let's write a great soul song for Otis Redding. To Love Somebody Was Born. And that became our song. But even though we wrote it for Otis Redding.
Okay, this is the song To Love Somebody, which was originally written for Otis Redding about 3 months before he died, so he never sang it.
We would love to have heard him sing it, but it never happened. And so we ended up, well, we ended up doing it ourselves. Yeah. There's a light, certain kind of light that never shone on me. I want my life to be live with you, live with his way. Everybody say to do each and every little thing, but what good does it bring if I ain't got you? Ain't got you. Baby,
you don't know what it's like. Baby, you don't know what it's like to love somebody, to love somebody the way I love you.
We try to experiment in different ways of setting up songs so that when you hear it on the radio, as soon as you hear the intro, you recognize the intro. And they go, oh, that's that Bee Gees record, or whatever. We did it right back to Love Somebody, which had the da 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 da, you know, which was just that, but strings playing it. And as soon as you heard it, you knew, after a few plays, you knew it was our record.
You don't know what it's like.
I read the Brothers Gibb as one of the greatest songwriting combinations of the 20th century. I think they're up there with Lennon and McCartney. I think they rank with people like Cole Porter and George Gershwin of their eras. Their songs have penetrated all classes, creeds, enormously successful. And I would like to wish Barry Gibb a very happy 50th birthday.
I thought they were influenced by the Beatles. I first heard about the Bee Gees when I was first recording, well, soon after I started recording the Beatles, because they were kind of, they were connected with Brian Epstein. They were kind of junior rivals, if you like.
Some of your early songs were very melancholy. Was there any particular reason for that?
There was a lot of sort of doom and gloom feeling in some of those songs, like Gotta Get a Message to You, because about a guy going to a chair. I mean, obviously appealing, because people obviously bought them, but there was a tremendous feeling of despair in those songs. And maybe that's just the way we were at the time. Maybe we were very sad people then.
We recorded it the same night as we finished the song, and Robert came in late that night, and what we hadn't done is we'd sung the whole song without doing the three-part harmony in the choruses. And Robert made us come back and sing the choruses again, and we said, well, why? He says, because you've got to sing them in three-part harmony. You can't sing it in unison and have no harmonies in the chorus. I want three-part harmony on those choruses, and that's the way Robert worked. So back we all drove to the studio and sang the song again in three-part harmony, and that's the record as it stands today.
And for once in my life, I'm alone. And I
At the height of their success, bitter arguments drove the brothers apart.
When we split, I was just turned 20. Lack of maturity. We got the first fame syndrome, all that stuff. It all started with 1st of May being the single, and the flip side was Lamplight. Once again, I was in the middle of this. I just wanted to point that out. And Robin was singing the lead on Lamplight, and Barry was singing the lead on 1st of May. And so there was also a bit of management problems too going on at that time, and each one was being told that you don't need the other brother, and all that sort of stuff was going down. And egos got in the way. And when you're 19, 20 years old, you know, it's like when managers promise you the world and what they can do for you, and, you know, you can really do it alone. You don't really need, you know. I never got told that. Only Robin and Barry did. So once again, I was in the middle. And the next minute, I hear that we're doing the Cucumber Castle film for television, and Robin's quit because 1st of May is going to be the A-side. He said, I've had enough.
I think that was a period where we had tremendous egos for success, where we just stopped talking to each other. We had people saying that you're responsible for the success of the group and he's successful. So we all had our own sort of court. And the only time we sort of knew what each other was doing or saying, a bit like Oasis today, is that we just pick up the papers and find out what's going on. You know, oh, he said that. Or, you know, and it's a terrible thing. You can't conduct. Or we were doing the same thing. There'd be a tour plan, America. We'd have an argument. The first person would be on the plane back to England, you know, arriving back at Heathrow. You know, we're out in the middle of a tour. And there was all these arguments going on.
When I realised it was over, it was when I turned up at the studio one night and I was the only one there. And the engineer said, well, okay, let's go anyway. And I said, well, I can't. How can I go? I mean, I just picked up my guitar and walked out. And went to Robert's house and said, well, you know, there was no one at the studio. And then I found out that Robin and Morris were recording somewhere else. And I thought, oh, no. This is the end, you know. So that's when I knew, you know. And Morris and I continued on for a while. Robin made a solo single, Saved by the Bell, which was a big hit. Morris and I made a single called Don't Forget to Remember, which was a big hit. But there was no happiness that went with it, you know. And it was 15 months. And then Robin came over one day and you know, we were all still pretty much out of it. I mean, there was still a lot of pills going on. And he came over and said, you know, we can put it all together if we really want to. We've got to try, you know. And we started strumming because we hadn't done that in 2 years, you know. And How Can You Mend a Broken Heart came from that. When you listen to the lyrics, it's perfectly apt, you know. It's actually what we were thinking.
I can think of younger days when living for my life was everything a man could want to do. I could never see.
How can you stop the rain from falling down? How can you stop the sun from shining? What makes the world go round?
How can you mend this broken man? How can a loser ever win? I can still feel the breeze that rustles through the trees and misty memories of days gone by. I could never see tomorrow. Down. How can you stop broken heart and let me live again.
We came back because we really love each other. I think that goes beyond any of the other aspects, you know. There may have been career need, but that we could not have come back together if there hadn't been this kind of the love that we have today. And these three guys went through everything from being children and made our way to the top. There are no other people around us that we can share those experiences with. It happened to the three of us. And so that's a bond, you know. And it exists today still.
Do you know, our careers has been like mountains and valleys. You know, it's been up and down like a yo-yo. We had a great period from 67 to 71 that was just unbelievable. We had lots of hits, everything went real well. We had our first two number ones in America, which was Lonely Days and How Can You Mend a Broken Heart. And then Run To Me, I think, came out, and that did fairly well. And after that, boom, nobody wanted to know us. The record company didn't want to know us. They weren't interested. Our management lost interest. Everybody moved out. All of a sudden, we were left alone. Our manager got interested in musicals with Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice. All of a sudden, we didn't have a career. We were like living in the Isle of Man. I even became a marshal on the TT races. You know, I mean, it was like dead zone, total dead zone. We didn't know what was going on. I was drinking a lot more, things like that. There was nothing to do then. Unless if you don't drink and you don't, you know, party all the time, there's nothing to do. So I got really bad in the drink, stuff like that. And we hardly, even though we lived on the island, Robin was still living in England because he managed to put a bit more aside than we did. And I ended up with a blue roller, Rolls Royce or something, and about $8,000 in the bank. That was it, after all the years we'd been working. And then I had to sell the Rolls, of course. And I lived in a little townhouse next to a fish and chip shop. That's all I could afford. Nothing in the bank. It was just nothing happening. And, of course, I'd just remarried then. My marriage with Lou had broken up by then. And I'd remarried, and we had a little six-month-year-old boy called Adam, and living in his townhouse. We couldn't even afford a cot. We used his pram top for his cot. And it was real rough, real rough. Mind you, the fish and chip shop was good. But it was really rough living there. It was bloody cold.
We had a conversation with Eric Clapton about making comebacks, because he was trying to make a comeback at the same. We're always trying to make comebacks. And Eric said, well, I've just made this album called 461 Ocean Boulevard in Miami. Why don't you guys go to America and do the same and make an album in America instead of always making an album in England? And maybe a change of environment will do something for you. So I think it was really good advice. We started recording in a studio called Criteria, which was actually a very famous studio for the Aretha Franklin records and the Eagles later on. And so here we were in this new environment, you know, and at the same time falling in love with Miami. And Jive Talking was part of that album. We'll be right back. Reminds me of Australia. It's my contact back with Australia again. I love living in a tropical climate.
It's the same with Arif Mardin when we did Jive Talking, which was basically, we were talking about the rock and roll jive. The jive, the dance. And he said, no, I've got to tell you, he said, it's a black expression for bullshitting. I'm doing his accent because he's a Turkish chap and he has this great accent. He goes, no, it's a black expression for bullshitting somebody. And we had Jive Talking, you dance with your eyes. And we changed it to Jive Talking, you're telling me lies. So we just changed the lyrics around. And he even gave us a groove, Arif. He said, this is what the tempo is going to be.
He made us far more aware of R&B music and the fact that it really was a part of our roots. White artists singing black music. It was something we did really well, and he brought that to our attention more. Leave the Beatlesque thing alone and get more into American music. So we did.
Yeah, excellent.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. It sounded great, yeah.
He was looking for one of us to scream in tune, if possible, at the end of Nights on Broadway. Mm. We didn't have any of those ad-libs, what you call scats or ad-libbing on the song. And he said, can one of you do that? And I said, well, I had done some falsetto in the past as part of harmonies. I said, so I'll go out and give it a shot and try. So I went out to the microphone and started doing this. Found out that I could sing in falsetto and had no knowledge about it my whole life until this point. And Arif said, that's really good. Can you actually do it with words instead of just screaming, So I tried and I found that I could do it with words and that I could sing actually a song in falsetto. And I'd never done this before. It never occurred to me to try it before. And so in a way, he was part of that discovery of the whole fever syndrome, whatever that sound was. And that was really the change for us. That was when records started to sell through the roof. And Robert called me up and said, I'm doing this film called Tribal Rights of a New Saturday Night from an article by Nick Kahn in the New York Post, I think it was. Do you have any suggestions for songs? Because you've never done songs for a movie and it might be a good experience. And I said, well, I'll call you back. Let me just think about it. So about an hour later, 2 hours later, I called him back and I said, well, the three titles come to mind. One is Staying Alive, and one is Night Fever. And I suggest that you don't call the film Tribal Rights of a New Saturday Night, that you've got to give it something that people are going to remember and something much shorter. And I suggest Night Fever as perhaps being the title of the film. And Rob, I remember Robert retorting and saying, oh no, that's far too pornographic. I said, we can't, that's too hot. We can't use that. So, and I said, well, okay. I said, but that's, I don't know why you think it's pornographic. I said, but those are the suggestions I have right off the bat. Know that anyone was going to call it disco, but they did, but it certainly wasn't in our minds. We wouldn't have called it disco. We thought it was R&B. You know, we liked the stylistics and the Delphonics and people who sang in falsetto. That was interesting to us because of our newfound falsetto thing. You know, so we weren't thinking in terms of what you might call the music. You know, and Staying Alive was born of those feelings and the lyric. There's a New York Times effect on man, I think, is in the lyric. And New York was, in fact, having that effect on the whole world at that point. Not so much California, but the Studio 54 and the nightlife and young people trying to find a future for themselves where, without this nightlife, there might not be a future, you know. And I think that the Tony character in Saturday Night Fever depicted that. Well, you can't say-
The subject matter of Staying Alive is actually quite a serious one. It's about surviving in the streets of New York, and the lyrics actually say that. It became such a phenomenon, the whole Saturday Night Fever thing, that very few people realize it's to do with anything but dance, but the lyrics don't talk about dance at all. And the lyrics very obviously state the scenario of survival in the city. And yeah, I mean, it's not about disco or dancing at all, actually.
The great thing about Staying Alive is that it had a great guitar hook to start with, which set up the scene and set up that pulsing beat. It's no coincidence, by the way, that the disco beat of 120 beats a second coincides with the heartbeat of your heart when you're excited. And this was a key thing that underlay the whole tune. And then when the vocals came in, the vocals were so designed that they pushed that beat further. They anticipated, in many cases, they came in before the bar line, and all the time it was surging forward. And very cleverly, they chose words to go with it, which also accentuated that. They leaned on those words. And when you have that combined with their impeccable three-part harmonies, it was electrifying. The harmonies also, the voices, were a kind of paradox, because everybody knows that they have quite high voices. But this was a very macho song, but portrayed by almost feminine voices, but beautifully done.
As far as I know, it's still the biggest selling soundtrack still.
Yeah.
And that was an incredible thing for me, because I used to love Sound of Music, and that was number one for years. And I never thought we'd ever knock Rodgers and Hammerstein off, you know? I mean, we got inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame, and above our picture was Rodgers and Hammerstein, and I can't believe that we're with these people, or even classed in the same class. You know, that was an amazing thing for me.
And how many records of that did you sell?
It was about 50 million, that one.
50 million?
Yeah.
It's just extraordinary, isn't it?
Yeah. And it's still the biggest selling soundtrack, I think, in history out there.
What did you think of the movie?
Yeah, I didn't see the movie very much. I still haven't seen the movie all the way through. Isn't that strange?
Eventually, when something like that becomes so successful, it becomes an albatross around your neck.
For about 10 years, we were, you know, we had some kind of leprosy, you know.
When you have five of your songs in the top 10 in Billboard and in every chart in the world, people are likely to get a bit fed up after a while, you know. Even Michael had it, you know, with the Thriller album. I mean, enough's enough. Come on, they're having Michael Jackson free weekends. Well, they had BG free weekends in different radio stations over America, particularly in Chicago. I mean, that was a really, oh, disco's dead, kill the disco kings. Things like this were going on, you know. It became pretty frightening.
There was many a single or many a record we put out in the past 15 years that a radio station would not even listen to, never mind play.
Why was that?
Because of the stigma.
The stigma? What's the stigma?
The stigma of Saturday Night Fever.
What's stigmatic about it? I still haven't got
it. I don't know. But where I'm sitting, it exists. And has existed. And now I think the veil is sort of just it's falling slowly because of this this new obsession with the 70s. So suddenly the Bee Gees are not so bad after all, you know. That's sort of happening now. And I'm bewildered again, you know. Well, now it's okay to like us, you know. So, you know, not only that, Staying Alive was fantastic. And it's in it's been in 15 movies since Saturday Night Fever. So for a song that was so shunned, or for an album that was so shunned, why is it that everybody wants it?
We became the proverbial guys in white suits. With the chains and the hairy chests and all that stuff.
So, you've decided to become a Bee Gee. Or pick up the vibrato bottles and keep taking the pills until the required wobble is achieved. Watching every day go by, changes my life, changes your life, keeps us all anticipating. We are searchers of the truth. Every man's a dog.
It never offended me. I thought it was one of the best giggles I've ever seen.
Oh, Kenny's brilliant. Kenny's was the best, without a doubt. The best impression I've ever seen. He had me on the floor. I could not believe how good that was. I miss him. He's a good guy. He was a real good guy.
When you look at the Bee Gees, you don't look at yourself, I guess. You're not objective about how you're perceived. But he nailed us, you know. Big hair, teeth, medallions. God. Hair's not so big now, folks.
Tragedy, that was written when we were doing the Sgt. Pepper film. We wrote that one and Too Much Heaven in the same afternoon. That was just turned out to be a fun sequencer type record. All this stuff was going on, which had never been heard before.
They use the word, and the word becomes the chorus almost. And that just that one word almost sums it up. They keep coming back to it time and again. They spit it out. And as it comes out, it kind of takes you back a bit. Then they go into the other words that sort of pad it out and rhythmically, beautifully, but always leads back to that word, the tragedy, keeps pointing at you. And it's so effective.
In 1978, the Bee Gees appeared in Sgt. Pepper, the movie, based on the Beatles' famous album.
The movie that should never have been made. If somebody said to you, I want to make the film Sgt. Pepper, and I want you to play a member of the band, you wouldn't say no, would you? You'd think, wow, that's fantastic. But you wouldn't imagine for a second it would turn out quite as bad as it did, you know.
For the benefit of Mr. Knight, there will be a show tonight on trampoline. The Hendersons will all be there. Later, Pablo, Frank is there. What a scene of a men and horses, hoops and garters. Lastly, through a hogshead of real fire. In this way, Mr. K will challenge the world.
Ah! It was such a camp film. A lot of people love it, actually, because it is camp.
It wasn't a particularly pleasant experience because we were between albums at the time, and before we'd just finished making Saturday Night Fever, recording Fever, and it was a contractual commitment for everybody at that time, including our manager Robert Stigwood, which we had to complete. It was a very undecided venture. Nobody really knew where we were going with it.
I think the movie of Sgt. Pepper should have been the making of Sgt. Pepper, because I thought that's where the real story was going on, you know?
Yeah.
The craziness of Hollywood. All these pop artists thrown together, making a movie where they weren't allowed to speak. And it was just madness.
It was a terrible film. The greatest thing about doing the Sgt. Pepper film was working with George Martin. To recreate the songs he originally did with the Beatles was wonderful.
They were so professional, all three of them. And whenever they came into the studio, they would joke a lot. They would fool around. But once the red light was on, they were in there and they were dead serious. And they were very precise, extremely precise. Their harmony singing was, I mean, they were very careful about intonation, impeccable about precision of ensemble. And in fact, they wanted to do things over and over again, much more than I did. I would be inclined to say, well, it's human, it's lovely. Oh no, we've got to get it right. And that when they double tracked so accurately, you could hardly tell it was double tracking. They were very, very good.
In the 1980s, the Bee Gees shifted gear, writing for and producing other performers.
They asked us, who would you love to produce? We said, Barbara Streisand. And then about a week later, Charles Cotman called us and said, I just read in the paper you'd love to do Barbara. So this is how Barbara's situation came about, and that she said she'd be very interested in working with you guys.
She wants to make an album that was a popular music album as opposed to Broadway-orientated songs that she'd been used to doing. And she wanted to do a song that was a contemporary album of songs that would be heard generally on Top 40 radio, and that's what we did.
It sort of took Barry out away from us for a bit, but understandably, it's a great song.
And we got nothing to begin to young, la la, we'll climb any mountain near or far we are, and we never made it.
Up to then, we'd always used our own voices as the instrument for our songs. And it's like switching instruments, and suddenly you can stretch the songs, you can make them do other things because it's someone else, you know. She became the adventure. I knew what she was capable of doing. I mean, if you were writing a script for an actor, you know what the spectrum of the actor is, you know what the actor can do. So you might write scenes that you would not write for another actor, you know. So in this case, this is what happened with Barbara Streisand. I was able to almost write a screenplay for her. To make her do something different.
What kind of fool?
Oh, I cried my eyes out after we wrote that. After we wrote Heartbreaker, I drove home and I went, oh, we should be doing this. We should be doing this one. And when she did it, it was brilliant.
you know, and we sang on it and stuff, and it was still became like a duet between the Bee Gees and Dionne Warwick. And that became her biggest selling single since Do You Know the Way to San Jose, which when we were kids, adored. All those songs by Bacharach and David. Burt Bacharach is one of probably them. Burt Bacharach and Hal David and Paul McCartney and John Lennon are probably the best songwriters I have ever heard in my life. And Burt's chords and Hal David's lyrics and things, it was just the melodies that Burt was coming up with. And I'm going, oh. And there we were working with Dionne Warwick. You know, she was their instrument, if you like, and doing a song which Burt Bacharach and Hal David usually only did. So we felt real honored. You know, it was a great experience.
I got to say it, and it's hard for me. You got me crying like I thought I would never be. Love is believing, but you let me down. How can I love you when you ain't around? And I get to the morning and you never call. Love should be everything or none at all. And it don't matter whatever you do, I'm better alive out of loving you. Only to find in your dream that a father is dying. I'm crying in the rain.
Why do you have to be a heartbreaker when I was being what you want me to be?
Sudden, everything I ever wanted has passed me by. This world may not you.
We actually see them all as one for ourselves. We see them as our songs as well, even though other artists have recorded them.
Islands in the Stream was an Ernest Hemingway book. Not that I've ever read them. I must admit, I'm not a big reader of Ernest Hemingway's, but the titles would stick out at you, and you'd say, would that make a great song? You know, and being Islands in the Stream, you know, being islands away from everybody else, you know, just being the two of us, you know.
We wrote Islands in the Stream for Diana Ross. It was written as an R&B song. So it just shows you the relationship between the two types of songs, that it could in fact turn into a country song very easily, and has in fact become the most successful country song in history, which is quite overwhelming in itself.
Baby, when I met you, there was peace unknown. I set out to get you with a fine tooth comb. I was soft inside, there was something going on. Something to me that I can't explain. Hold me closer and I feel no pain. Every beat of my heart, we got something going on. Tender love is blind, it requires a dedication. All this love we need no conversation. We ride it together, uh-huh. Making love with each other, uh-huh. Islands in the stream, that is what we are. No one in between, how can we be wrong? Sail away with me to another world, when we rely on each other, uh-huh. From one lover to another, uh-huh.
Slowly losing sight of the real way.
1985 saw the Bee Gees penning a whole album for Diana Ross.
We'd done the whole album, and she was still... she said, well, you know, we still need one more song from somewhere. And we'd had Chain Reaction all along. We just hadn't had the nerve to play it to her because it was so Tamla Motown-ish that we were actually scared that she wouldn't want to go back there.
We said, we think, you know, it's time we did something that you would have done with the Supremes and not as Diana Ross. It's time to do that again. And she didn't really think that was going to be appropriate at the time. And it wasn't until after she recorded it and sat down and heard it that she thought it was right. And it was a credible kind of tribute to her own past.
You took a mystery and made me want it. You got a pedestal and put me on it. You made me love you out of feeling nothing. Something that you do. And I was there not dancing with anyone. You took a little, then you took me over. You set your mark on stealing my heart away. Trying, anything for you. I'm in the middle of a chain reaction. You give me all the after midnight action. I wanna get you where I can let you make all that love to me.
The Bee Gees don't just record, they create their songs in the studio. Right. This new one's called Just In Case.
It's usually a romantic song. It's either two people or it's three people. Or it could be four people, depending on what mood you're in. In this case, it's a situation where the girl is trying to protect herself because it's really a girl's song. And in this situation, she doesn't want to give her heart away. So she's it's just in case. This is not the real thing. I don't want to give myself to you.
What are you doing on the keyboards then, Morris? How are you feeling?
We're sort of doing an arrangement at the same time as we're going.
Find out where the heat is.
And you haven't got all the words at the moment?
No.
All right. Well,
so this is basically what it is. Okay. And from here on, what you'll hear is us scatting to find the melody, the right melody. Morris will very often come up with a chord we did not expect him to play. And in fact, sometimes it's something he didn't expect to play.
It usually happens, in which case we usually kill him, or severely beat him.
I have to find someone to tell me which one it was.
Yeah, right.
Was it the black ones or the white?
just talk me through that one section.
A minor. G.
G.
Yeah.
And then
to D.
No.
What was that?
I think it's B flat.
Was it? It's another chord I played.
Into a minor. Or it could be that. Go to G minor.
Yeah.
All right. At some point, we establish exactly what the melody is note for note. And then when we do our lyrics, we don't detract from that melody. We don't change the melody to go with certain words we may like. We religiously make the words fit the melody we've pre-established.
This is basically the way we always write. I mean, not always like this, but in terms of when we get the lyric, the idea of the melody and the title together.
We look for the core of the idea. What is the core of the song?
And you're telling me this is love, but just in case, keep my heart in a secret place, safe.
No,
okay, yes.
B flat minor.
Yeah, right. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I said. The words that are there, how have they arrived there? Are all the words there? Are these just words?
In this case, it was just those first four lines. This is love, but just in case, I'll keep my heart in a secret place, safe under lock and key, till I know it's only me. And that thought in itself really is the whole message of the song.
I think the verse is actually shaping up pretty good. I think it just needs to be cleared up at the end of the choruses. Yeah.
Can you show us the bit that isn't working and tell me what you're going to do about it?
right there, we've got to find something else, right?
Yeah.
So what are you going to do? What are you going to do about finding something
else? Well, we had something we actually did before, which was when we went to the G minor.
Oh, yeah.
That E. Then the yeah. B flat minor.
Right, and that takes you back to the verse again. Yeah,
that's something
like
a possibility. That could
yeah,
work.
Yeah.
And once we've established that, then it's ready to sit down and write lyrics to.
The DAT's always continuously running with the ideas as we go down. Then once we get a sort of format of the idea, then we'll put it in a sort of rough sketch and take that tape with us and make a cassette of the last 20 minutes of writing and go to Barry's place, sit down, play it, listen to it, and then we all start thinking of the storyline, where it's going, you know, and so forth.
The important thing about a good quality song is that the statement has to say everything within a few words. And I think that's what we're looking for, to say a lot in just a few words simply, so that everybody can relate to it. Mm. And I think that's the important, I think the key to a successful song, is that everybody hears a lot in the statement of the song. And it's not so much an intricate story as a statement that everything else evolves around.
Has this song started with those first four lines then? Is that how this one started?
Yes.
Yeah.
Where did they come from?
Well, it was an idea I had. And then the first reaction I got was Robin sort of saying, well, maybe it should be called Under Lock and Key.
Or just Lock and Key.
And we sort of argued about that for about an hour, because I really felt that the whole concept was just in case. Yeah. That's really what you're talking about, somebody playing safe. And so I believed that that was right, you know. And Robin believed that Lock and Key might be better. So we argued about that for a while.
And we kept arguing, and we came to blows.
We came to blows.
In
1987, after 8 years' absence from the top ten, the Bee Gees struck gold with You Win Again.
We had all these sounds that we put together, which became a stomp. And everybody thought, no, don't put that on the record, no, no. And when they first heard it, everybody wanted it off the record. And we loved it, because it had this great big champ, champ, and now people are asking me for samples of it.
I woke up about 3 o'clock in the morning with this melody. That was all I had. And I thought, what is that? And if I wake up tomorrow morning, I won't remember it. So I had to go and find a tape recorder and put that little bit of melody on tape. And sometimes I do that, and the next day it's rubbish, you know, and you throw it away. But the next day it still meant something. And so I played it to Morris and Robin. And they said, oh, yeah. Let's finish it and see what happens.
Another fine singer the Bee Gees wrote for was Andy Gibb, their own tragically ill-fated younger brother.
Andy was about 8 years younger. Andy was a very complex kind of person and wasn't really one of the Bee Gees, although a lot of people thought he might have been.
I think it was always because we were the older brothers and that we'd had this career that had already gone on for about 20 years or so, and he'd always been the little brother. And once he had his first hit, at that point, I don't think he wanted to be in the Bee Gees. He wanted his own identity.
He was his own worst enemy, in fact. He had I don't think he really knew where he was going, what he wanted to do. I'm not even sure whether he would have really wanted to have stayed in music or do something else. But even now, after, 8 years after he died, I still don't really think I knew him. And I don't think the three of us can really say that.
We did this tour in 79, the Spirits tour, and when the fever stuff was really hot, and it was quite an exciting time for all of us. We opened up in Fort Worth, Texas, and then we were in Houston. Andy was there, and he just had a couple of hits, and he was doing real well. And he joined us on stage, and I think it was probably one of the best nights I can remember.
Ladies and gentlemen, our brother Andy!
Just seeing Andy, I think, at that time, so high on health and so blown away with what was happening. We were all looking at each other going, can you believe this is happening? Because it was a dream. It was something that I don't think many, many groups or many artists get to ever experience, but it was something like you can never forget. And to see it in his eyes, with the tears in his eyes while he was doing it, it was like, can we believe this is all happening? And I'll never forget that. That was probably one of the best nights I've ever had on stage, I think.
I've often said, although I know it's not entirely true, I've often said that Hollywood is the reason that Andy died, you know. It's a very dangerous environment for someone that's susceptible to drugs or has an addiction type of personality, because you can get anything you want in Hollywood, you know, and it's readily available. And while he was in Miami, the whole time we were making records, it was good, and he was good, and he was healthy, and he was leading a healthy lifestyle. And at some point, he got in with the wrong people and decided he had to live in Hollywood and went to Hollywood. And from then on, everything started to go the wrong way.
Did you ever feel like giving up along the way?
Well, open a pig farm up in Devon. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You know, when you feel like I think the times are when you get so much success and people just say, well, you're not allowed to have any more. You know, that's it now. It's time to rip you apart. Things like when Andy died, you know, I mean, the press on that stuff was a killer. I felt like, how could they? You know, you feel like you just want to say sod it all, you know. If I wasn't doing this, I wouldn't get this attention, you know.
What upset you about the press? Anyway?
Well, the lies, just pure lies. I mean, they didn't know any truth at all. I mean, to put it in a quick line, they used a local pub in Oxfordshire called Thatcher's, and all the press were there because it happened at Robin's house at the hospital. He was living in Robin's house down the road in Oxfordshire, in Tame. And they used this little pub as a headquarters for the press. And one of the guys ran in, picks up the phone, and started calling his editor. He said, I've got some bad news, Chief. He goes, yeah? He says, yeah, it was natural causes. That, to me, put the whole thing in a nutshell.
This is a kid who learned to fly 3 months before he died. So it's hard to say that it was too much drugs or too much drink. However, that was his problem. Towards the end, he went into a downhill spiral. He just went into drinking about as much as he could. And then, after he died, we found out that he had a heart disease and that he knew this, that he'd known it for the last couple of years, but he'd never told anybody.
Nobody gets too much heaven no more. It's much harder to go.
I love this room. I love this room very much. This is, it's not a very old house, but they're very old beans. I may be wrong, but I think this house was used for children during the Blitz. Sometimes on a dark night, you can hear children's voices. We took this property about 1980, 1981. So we've been here about 16 years. The kids have had a fantastic time here. It's a pity we don't spend more time here, but they love it. Nippy.
I'm a bit nippy. I tell you what, I wish I had my gloves.
Now that we're alone, no more hide-and-seek. You are the highest dream to me, and as you softly sleep, then I can tell you what it means. Locked in my arms like love is life, I will not let you slip away. Is this the summer of them all? Is it my night of nights that you came to stay?
You are owner of my heart, just the way that love should be. And there is something I must say to you.
If you promise to believe that it's you I'm living for, then I could not love you more. These are the truest words I know.
These two things I do.
This is the summer of our lives, one love that cannot die.
You are owner of my soul. Never let you say goodbye.
Away from the Miami studio, Robin enjoys his Oxfordshire home, an ancient church building.
OK, this is the Great Hall, what's left of it. This has got quite a good history. This is where they had the court to decide on the sentencing of Joan of Arc, who was burned in France. This took place in here, along with other sentences for local people, which included being whipped bareback up and down the High Street of Tame for things like adultery and other offences. I had the house about 10 years. It's about 800 years old. It was built by Robert Grosseteste in the 1100s and has been the home of the Bishops of Lincoln right up until the Reformation. I love history, and I love certain parts of history. I love the Elizabethan period. I also love the Georgian period and Victorian. I particularly like the Elizabethan period.
When we filmed with him in Miami, Maurice Gibb was between homes. All three brothers are involved in local and national charities.
We all have separate ones, as well as one we do, like diabetes. We raise a lot of money for diabetes and have a ball every year. I do Police Athletic League for the young kids of Miami, and also for slain officers' families, things like that, raise money for them. Robin has the Abuse Children charities and AIDS, and we're all involved in the AIDS one as well. So yeah, we do a lot of that sort of thing, and also of course the hurricane relief. There was a big hurricane relief concert being planned to raise money for Miami, and we said yes, we'd love to do that. We did the show, and it was the most amazing thing we'd ever seen. I mean, the whole place came alive. It was just magic. The audience went crazy. It was like everybody started dancing.
Just me and you, just me and you. Someday, maybe you and I should be one. Oh yeah, you've been always brighter than the eye can see behind the sun. Oh yeah, maybe I'll tell you someday. Maybe you and I should be one. You and I should be one. One, do it always brighter than the eye can see behind the sun. Tell you someday, maybe you and I should be one.
They sing as magnificently now as I remember them 30 years ago. They haven't lost any range, and you know the voice is a muscle like everything else. And as we all get a little older, you lose your range, you lose whatever. It needs to be worked on all the time. And I see no difference in the way they sing now as to when I was just a fan like everybody else. Next to the Beatles, they were probably the most creative group ever. On the up-tempo song, which is called I Surrender, which I think is just a out-and-out smash hit, bottom-line, 90s, modern, put it on the radio tomorrow and it's right there with everything else. That was really a gift, and in fact, I encouraged them to be co-producers with me on that because the demo was so well-constructed. Half the work was already done, so I thought it was only fair to include them as co-producers.
I Surrender.
Right? And we're going to have to kind of just nail this and double it, go ahead.
Well, the process for the Bee Gees, obviously, if you listen to the records closely, they were very serious about the process. And I'm happy to report, 30 years later, they're still just as serious. After I've signed off on something, quite often, Barry is still in there working.
Heaving up the skull.
What was wrong with that? Absolutely nothing.
I think there's a lot of thought that goes in and play it and listen to it the next day, but not to the point of being a fanatic about it. Just wanted to get it absolutely right, and that's their style.